Ladies and gentlemen, dear Professor Batnitzky, dear Professor Emon, it is my great pleasure this evening to welcome you to the Blumenthal Academy here at the Jewish Museum in Berlin. My name is Leontine Meijer-van Mensch, and I'm the museum's program director. This evening is the final event in our third series of lectures with this year focused on Jewish and Islamic perspectives on human rights. And our event this evening is being held under the auspices of the Academy's Jewish Islamic Forum, which we host, among other things, with the aim of strengthening Jewish-Muslim relations. I would also like to take the opportunity to thank the Allianz Kulturstiftung for their generous support for this series. Thank you so much. At each event within the series, we invite two scholars who represent the Jewish and Muslim perspectives on a particular issue. Previous events in the series have provided opportunities for discussion on how Judaism and Islam interpreted concepts of human rights within their respective religious traditions, covering both the commonalities and the tensions that arise between them and human rights discourse. What discussion have Jews and Muslims had, and do they have them about human rights now? What debates are provoked by the right to live and to physically integrity or the right to freedom of expression? How are issues of gender equality constructed theologically? These were all questions that came up at previous sessions, and today we will be tackling another controversial issue head on, the right to freedom of conscience and religion. Our purpose is to probe how Judaism and Islam respond theologically to other worldviews and religion, both monotheistic and polytheistic. Are followers of other faiths accorded freedom of religion and freedom of worship? If so, under what conditions? And how do Judaism and Islam deal with the issue of apostasy? That means changing one's religion. A charge frequently leveled at Islam is that Islamic jurisprudence is prepared to acknowledge freedom of conscience for non-Muslims, but is not prepared to afford it to its own followers. But how did traditional Islamic law truly treat those who left the faith and the community? In many European countries, Muslims and Jewish communities have repeatedly and explicitly acknowledged the freedom of conscience for all as a basic tenet of social order. How can contemporary Judaism and Islam guarantee human rights and justify that guarantee theologically without exposing their claim to reveal absolute truth to question? I'm so delighted we have been able to secure two such eminent experts for today's panel. I really am. Professor Leora Batnitzky and Professor Anver Emon. Before introducing them to you, let me remind you that today's talk will be in English, I already said that, and that there are headsets at the side of the room. And another important point is today's talk is also taking place in the Muslim holy month of Ramadan. And so we would like to invite all our guests to a joint iftar after our event here in the Academy. And now for our first guest. Leora Batnitzky is Ronald O. Perlman Professor of Jewish Studies and Chair of the Department of Religion at Princeton University. Her teaching and research interests include philosophy of religion, modern Jewish thought, hermeneutics, and contemporary legal and political theory. She's co-editor of Jewish Studies Quarterly. She's the author of lots of books, and one of them is very recent, How Judaism Became a Religion, An Introduction to Modern Jewish Thought, and it was released in 2011. Her current book project, tentatively titled Conversion Before the Law, How Religion and Law Shape Each Other in the Modern World, focuses on a number of contemporary legal cases concerning religious conversion in the US, Great Britain, Israel, and India, which I thought was very interesting. And you're also the co-editor with Jonathan Breffman of an anthology, Jewish Legal Theories for the Brandeis Library of Modern Jewish Thought. Quite impressive. Professor Batnitzky, we are very much looking forward to your talk. I'll pour you a glass of water in this very beautiful designerish. Gareth, and I'm very much, and we all are very much looking forward to your talk. Thank you so much.
Okay. Thank you very much. Can everyone hear me? Okay. Thank you to the Jewish Museum. Thank you to the organizers. It's a pleasure to be here this evening with you, and I'm especially pleased to be able to have a dialogue and conversation with Professor Anver Emon about the two issues we were asked to speak about this evening. First of all, Judaism's or Islam's view of other religions, and second, about apostasy. So, okay, let me begin by saying that I think both of these questions really raise a question about tolerance. And so this is supposed to be an image of tolerance over here. And that every conversation that we have, of course, exists within a context. And the context, I think, this evening does have to do with this question of tolerance. I think that today, often questions about the relations between religions and apostasy are often asked with a backdrop assumptions about something that's good religion versus bad religion. Good religion is tolerant and tolerates religious freedom as within a group, but also the religious freedom of people outside of the group, whereas not so good religion is less tolerant. But I want to step back from this a bit in order to think about some of the complexity of asking these questions and these questions about tolerance and some of our assumptions about tolerance, and to think about some of the kind of complicated history behind this. Specifically, I'll talk about, of course, Judaism. So I'm going to divide my remarks into two parts. In the first part, I'm going to talk a little bit about modern conceptions of religion and religious freedom in human rights discourse. And I want to talk about them in relationship to pre-modern and modern Judaism. That'll be the first part. And then in the second part, I'm going to turn to our two questions about other religions and apostasy, and I'm going to try and reflect in what I'm talking about what are some of our assumptions about tolerance today. Okay, so this is here. This is Article 9 of the European Convention of Human Rights. It's actually pretty similar to the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, its description of religion. And I think that the idea of what religious freedom is here is what many people, and this is absolutely the case in the United States, obviously a context I know better than I know the context here, but this is what people just assume religion is. And I want to just raise the question of, is this really what religion is? So I'll just read this. Everyone has the right to freedom of thought, conscience, and religion. This right includes freedom to change his belief or religion or belief, and freedom either alone or in community with others, and in public or private, to manifest this religion or belief in worship practice, worship teaching practice and observance. Okay, so here we see that religion's implicitly or explicitly defined in terms of conscience. Religion seems to be a kind of conscience in line with thought. And when this article was expanded, the European Commission and the Court of Human Rights went further and really emphasized this notion of interiorized individual belief, describing religion as a forum internum, so kind of something inside. So Article 9, of course, does allow for collective forms of religion, but I want to emphasize, and I want you to notice, that when it's talking about collective forms of religion are is described as a bunch of individuals who decide to get together with other individuals who share their religious beliefs. And so while, on the one hand, this is a collective form of religion, it is also very much an idea of religion that's rooted first and foremost in the individual. Whoops, don't want to spoil it for you. Okay, so let me say something about then the brief history of religion and also about the Hebrew term dat, which I'll say about in a second. And all of this is to say is that what we call religion today, certainly in this article of the European Convention of Human Rights that I quoted here, is not the way in which historically most people, Jews, Christians, Muslims, perhaps others, would have understood the term religion or the comparable term religion. And so this notion of privatized individual belief is very much a modern idea. And the terms religion and dat, historically understood, actually referred not to individual beliefs or what's my individual feelings inside, but instead referred to rituals and to practices which were often communal in nature, okay, and really had to do with the way in which the individual bound his or herself to these practices. So today, in at least the European Convention of Human Rights, as we see there, this notion of religion is not only individualized and interiorized, but it also epitomizes freedom. Actually, historically speaking, the term religion and the Hebrew term dat actually refer to practices that were not individualized and that were also about things that the individual had to do. So very different from our notions of today of what religion is. So why was there the shift? And it's really interesting, as a side point, there's a real interesting parallel between the Latin transformation of this term religion and the Hebrew transformation of the term dat, which historically meant law, and not just Jewish law, could have been any law. But today, the term, if some of you know a little bit of Hebrew, dati, to describe a religious person, that's a modern coinage, okay? And the histories are quite parallel to one another. So why did these terms change? So there are lots of reasons why these terms changed. I'll just give you a couple of them. One of them, in the terms of the context of religion and the Latin use, had to do with Christian colonialists and the way in which Christian colonialists wanted to describe what other people who didn't seem to be Christian were doing. That was one of the transformations. But what's interesting is that by the 18th century, which is not that long ago, a little bit long ago, not that long ago, religion had already come to mean personal belief or faith, and this is where we have in English this term faith, and in German this term Glaube, really increasing in usage. So I'll just leave it at that, but I want to give you one very basic reason why we have this transformation, and that's what I'm going to focus on. So the major transformation has to do with the modern nation state, okay? And the modern idea of sovereignty. And this I want to suggest, it's obviously much more complicated than this, but I want to suggest this evening, is that this view of religion as private belief goes hand in hand with the notion of national sovereignty, an idea that began to develop in the 16th century, but of course developed further, which basically came to define the state as the only legitimate site of collective identity. So as the state came to be understood as sovereign, as a kind of centralized power over individuals, there was very little room left for what today we call religion. And so religion, what it historically had been, got smaller and smaller, okay, with the state, and it became reduced to the individual and the individual's internal life. Now again, of course, there's a much more complicated than this, but just as a kind of general outline, this is what I want to use. And I want to turn now then to the modern Jewish experience, which I think is actually extraordinarily informative for thinking about these issues. And just one thing in the context of this forum, which seems so interesting, and again, it's a pleasure to be here, is many of the issues that come up today in terms of, say, Islam and modern liberalism, or Islam versus Christianity, clash of civilizations, as some people call it, we can see these same conversations happening for about 300 years in Jewish thought. And so this is one of the very exciting reasons, for me at least, that is to be here this evening. So I want to talk a little bit about the history of Jewish emancipation and how this relates. Let me see. Okay, so this is just a map which gives you some general dates about Jewish emancipation. No one's expected to memorize it, just for your information. So as I said, the European Jewish response to the creation of sovereign European states is instructive for thinking about this contemporary idea about religion. Prior to becoming citizens of modern nation states, and these are just the dates where in different places Jews became citizens of modern nation states in Europe, Jews were not defined as individuals. No one was defined as an individual, but Jews were defined in terms of their membership in a Jewish community. Now, a particular Jewish community's right to exist in a particular place depended on the whim of others, usually the nobility or the royalty, and Jews often performed some kind of useful service in order to have the rights to exist. But one thing that's very interesting that's often still overlooked nowadays in some discussions is that Jewish communities also had a lot of autonomy. They ruled themselves. Of course, they were subject to external rule, meaning they had to pay taxes, had to do things for the external rulers, but they also had a lot of rule over themselves. So for instance, the Jewish community was responsible to maintain within Jewish communities law and order. The Jewish community had the right to punish its individual members, had the right to collect taxes, to imprison people, but also very much acted as kind of social services for people, and really being Jewish in a pre-modern context was holistic, with an H here, holistic in the sense that what we today call religious versus political versus cultural, you really don't have these distinctions in a pre-modern context. Being Jewish is simultaneously a religious, cultural, and a political identity. So now we come here to Moses Mendelssohn, okay? So this idea, if we're gonna say this idea of Jewish religion, this idea that Judaism somehow can conform with this contemporary notion of religion as an individual belief was actually invented, I want to suggest, right here in Berlin by Moses Mendelssohn, and there's a picture of him, and I'm pretty sure this painting belongs to the museum. Okay. So Mendelssohn developed this idea in the context of the German Enlightenment, but at the time that he wrote, Jews, including Mendelssohn himself, had no individual rights. And Mendelssohn was publicly challenged to defend himself, to either defend Judaism or convert to Christianity. Mendelssohn was known actually as the Socrates of Berlin. Everyone thought, you know, Mendelssohn is so smart, and there was lots of reason to think this, but it got him into trouble because people thought, if he's so smart, why doesn't he convert to Christianity? And so he had to publicly make an argument for why he was not going to convert to Christianity. And it was a tricky thing to make this kind of argument because the Jewish community was subject to collective punishment. So he didn't want to offend his audience, but he nonetheless wanted to argue for the right to be Jewish. So if anyone's interested in that argument, you can read his book, Jerusalem. I highly recommend it. It's an interesting book. But he very much came in that book to defend the idea that Judaism is a religion and that Jews could be and should be members of the modern nation state, in this case the Prussian state, as individuals and not as a collective. So very much this idea of Jewish religion or Judaism as a religion or how Judaism became a religion really goes hand in hand with the modern nation state, with the modern Rechtsstaat, okay, the development. They go hand in hand and you don't really have one without the other. And so there's a lot of, if some people are interested, there's a lot of work done on showing how this modern idea of religion, again, defined as individual belief, really does have to do with the shrinking of what used to be religion in a much broader sense, a shrinking to this idea of individual conscience. And I'll just quote another German Jew since we're here. Leo Strauss, I think, put this very well. He said, quote, Liberalism stands or forms by the distinction between state and society, or by the recognition of the private sphere protected by the law, but impervious to the law, with the understanding that above all, religion as particular religion belongs to the private sphere, end quote. So the idea is that liberalism, the modern nation state, the idea of the rule of law goes hand in hand with this idea of religion as privatized and individualized. Now, there can be no doubt that historically speaking, Judaism stands in tension with conceptions of religion and religious freedom characterized only in terms of private belief. And Mendelssohn himself, by the way, was quite aware of this tension. That's one of the reasons why Jerusalem is such an interesting book. And it's not just Judaism, of course. Many other religions, including Islam, I think also including many forms of Christianity, such as Catholicism, also stand in tension with this notion of religion as individualized internal belief. But I want to leave that big issue aside and turn now to what the questions we were asked to answer this evening in this context and to think about Judaism's view of other religions and apostasy. So I'm going to turn to apostasy first, if that's okay, and I'm going to come back to other religions. So you can't really understand Judaism's view of apostasy, I think, without understanding what it means to convert to Judaism. Because understanding what it means to convert to Judaism, I think, gives us some insight into the question of what does it mean to be a Jew. And of course, this is a giant question. Lots of people argue about it. But generally speaking, I think the conversion gives us this question. Now, what does it mean to convert to Judaism? First of all, I'll return to this point. Jews have not, since about the 4th century, people debate this, but let's just say the 4th century, have not sought to convert people to Judaism. It's possible to convert to Judaism, but the idea is not that everyone in the world should convert to Judaism, and that's very, very important for what I'm going to talk about, okay? So in order to convert to Judaism, from a legal point of view, there are really just two points. One of them has to do with circumcision, for a man, obviously, and then immersion in a ritual bath, and that's just a picture of a ritual bath, of a mikveh. But the Talmud, where we find what today we would call the conversion ceremony, doesn't say really what that means, it just describes it. And so let's think about what it does mean. So here, there are two parts to the conversion ceremony before circumcision and the mikveh. One is binding oneself to the Jewish people, and I'll say something more about that in a second. And the second is accepting the law, and I'll say something more about that in a second. Okay, so this is a quote from the Talmud, and this is what the first thing when someone comes to convert, you're supposed to say to them is, why have you decided to approach us to be converted? Do you not know that Israel at this time is pained, oppressed, harassed, and torn, and that afflictions come upon them? Okay, so the Talmud tells rabbis that when people approach them to convert, the first thing they should say is, you're kidding, why would you want to be part of this people? It's really not a very good deal, okay? But then if the convert says, no, I know that it doesn't seem to be a great deal, but I still want to be part of the people, then they can proceed, okay? Now, conversion, I'm going to go back. Okay, I'm coming back to that. Okay, all right. So conversion, I want to quote here from Shia Cohen, who's written a really good book. It's been written a while ago called The Beginnings of Jewishness, if anyone's interested in the topic. But let me just quote from him. Conversion is understood primarily in terms of enfranchisement. The potential convert is asked, why have you decided to approach us to be converted? And again, at what I just read, do you not know that Israel is at this time oppressed, etc.? If the candidate says, I know and I'm unworthy, he is accepted and is given instruction in a few of the light commandments and a few of the severe commandments. But it doesn't specify what's the light and what's the severe. At the end of this, he is circumcised and becomes like an Israelite in all respects. What is missing, this is Cohen writing, is really any kind of mention of any kind of change of belief or change in spirituality. Okay. And now Cohen mentions perhaps this is implicit, but it's not explicit. The Talmud doesn't tell us what the convert should be feeling inside. So what's very important here is that we see that conversion to Judaism means two things at once, okay? And so you may wonder what are these pictures of. One is, I'll start from your right. This is Abraham over here. looking up at the stars. Okay, it is about an individual, of course. Okay, and an individual's relationship to God, but simultaneously, it's also about binding oneself to the Jewish people. So this other painting here is a painting of Naomi and Ruth from the Book of Ruth, and I want to emphasize, by the way, that of course that's not yet Jewish, that's biblical in that context, but if you recall in the Book of Ruth, Ruth says to Naomi, when Naomi says, go home to your own people, Ruth says, no, your people are my people, your God is my God. Wherever you go, I will go, your people are my people, your God is my God. And so what we see here is, again, that converting to Judaism means really becoming part of the people, along with some kind of individual relationship, presumably, to God, that we don't hear much about it. And in fact, when someone converts to Judaism, they take on a new lineage. Their new name comes to be so-and-so, either son of Abraham and Sarah or daughter of Abraham and Sarah. So it's as if they actually have a new lineage. And once again, I know I'm repeating myself, but we see how little the individual's interiority matters in all of this. Okay, so what does this have to do with our topic tonight? Well, one of the interesting things is that when we come to proselyte or to apostasy, okay, sorry, proselytes, conversion, when we come to apostasy, one of the things is that from the point of view of classical Jewish sources, someone who is an apostate, who leaves Judaism, is still a Jew, okay, but a bad Jew, okay, but they're still Jewish, and we see this specifically in the context of this issue of conversion. So even someone who's converted to Judaism, if they then, this is the context here, if they then return to their old ways, or if they did it because they weren't really sincere, according to the Talmud and according to the Shulchan Aruch, which is the great medieval code of Jewish law, it just means that they're an apostate Jew, a mishumad, but they're still Jewish, okay? It means they're just like any other bad Jew, okay? So what's interesting is that whether one is a Jew by birth or a Jew by conversion, you can't, from the perspective of Judaism, stop being a Jew, okay? You can be a bad Jew, but you can't stop being a Jew. So I want to think about what this means in terms of tolerance, back to our picture. On the one hand, from the point of view of contemporary notions of religion and religious freedom, this seems pretty intolerant. In the sense that if a Jew says, well, I'm no longer Jewish, I'm now, this is what I believe, the rabbinic tradition says, well, tough, you're still Jewish, we don't care. So it doesn't seem to really respect very much an individual's own, the importance of the individual's own belief. Yet on the other hand, I want to emphasize, there's a way in which this actually is somewhat tolerant. In that there's room, at least classically understood, I'm not talking about historically what Jews have actually done, that's another story, individuals, what they've done. But classically understood, there's room within a conception of Jewishness for Jews to have different kinds of identity. Again, they can still be considered a bad Jew, but they're still Jewish. So I want to suggest that there is actually a kind of tolerance for difference in here. So let's turn then to our question about other gods and idolatry. Well, I'm calling it an idolatry. So usually when the Jewish tradition, and I'm speaking very broadly here, has bad things to say about other religions, it's in the context of calling those other religions idolatrous. And here, of course, is a cartoon of the golden calf where Israelites themselves, we can anachronistically call them Jews themselves, are worshiping a golden calf, and that's the image of idolatry. And of course, the biblical text itself has lots of bad things to say about idolatry and makes fun of idols. If you think about Psalm 115, they have eyes, but they can't see, they have ears, and they cannot hear, et cetera, et cetera. There is a lot of derision, yet something that's interesting is that the what counts as idolatry, historically understood, it really changes over time. So even if we turn to someone like Josephus and Philo, okay, relatively close to the rabbis, they argue that Jews actually shouldn't ridicule pagan cults because those pagan cults are actually in keeping with the same understanding of monotheism. That's just an example I'm using just to say that we shouldn't take these things as static, that what counts as idolatry, again, in one context might be idolatrous, in another context is not. So let's come here to this question of Judaism, Christianity, and Islam. And I have to say, when I was looking for an image, it's very interesting to see the order that the symbols are put in. And I've, meaning, you know, sometimes it's Christianity on top, the others on the bottom, or et cetera, et cetera. My order just reflects his history. Okay, so what is the relationship to Christianity and Islam from a Jewish point of view? So there's a long history of Jewish debates about whether Christianity and Islam ought to be considered either monotheistic or idolatrous. And I don't think there's one clear answer about where Judaism as a tradition comes down on this. A number of medieval thinkers, such as Maimonides, recognized that Jews and Christians actually share a biblical text, and therefore was somewhat, depending on your interpretation, more open to Christianity, even though he also saw aspects of Christianity, such as the Trinity, as being closer to idolatry. But I think these have changed over time, because again, context matters and changes over time. I have one more reference to a painting here in the Jewish Museum, and this is to Abraham Geiger, right? This is, I think the Jewish Museum has this. Abraham Geiger was the, oh, I'm sorry, I put my picture too close over there. But anyway, Abraham Geiger was the founder of what we call today Reform Judaism or Liberal Judaism. And Abraham Geiger was one of many German Jews who actually made strong arguments about the affinity between Judaism and Islam, okay? And many German Jews actually made arguments about the Golden Age of Spain as being this model for what they hoped would be a German-Jewish symbiosis. And one reason why they really, Geiger in particular, emphasized this affinity with Islam was that they wanted to describe Judaism and Islam as rational and tolerant as against the kind of Protestantism in the German academy at that time, which was at the very least anti-Jewish, if not anti-Semitic. And so I mention this one because, of course, we're here in Berlin, and it's worth mentioning these German Jews, but also because I think the question of when Jews have historically felt more affinity with either Christianity or Islam has a lot to do with different historical contexts. Okay. But I want to come back to our issue of tolerance. I've given you the briefest and vaguest of overviews of the subject, but I want to say something conceptually about Judaism's relationship to other religions, which I think may be a bit different from Islam or Christianity's view. And I leave this for discussion. So on the one hand, Judaism is a very particular religion. It is about a relationship between the Jewish people and God. But on the other hand, Judaism, even from a biblical perspective, is a universal religion. And I'll just quote to you from Genesis 12:2, when God says to Abraham, "I will make you a great nation, and I will bless you and make your name great, and you will be a blessing." So this idea that you will be a great nation, but you will be a blessing to all, kind of gets at this question of the particularism and universalism. But Judaism's particularity and its relationship to universalism suggests at least two things when we think about, conceptually speaking, Judaism's relationships to other religions. First of all, not everyone from a Jewish point of view needs to be or should be Jewish, okay? Second of all, since God is the God of all humanities, God has to have relationships with other people as well, okay? So by definition, on the one hand, there is this particularism, but on the other hand, the universalism suggests that actually there have to be legitimate ways for other people to have relationships with God. And once again, I emphasize that Judaism has historically not been a religion that has tried to convert people in large numbers to Judaism. So what does this mean in terms of thinking about tolerance? Now, of course, we all know that historically speaking, still today, many people find Jewish particularism offensive. They think that this means that Judaism doesn't care about other people or other religions. But I want to suggest that that point of view, which unfortunately has been a relatively common point of view historically, that point of view actually only necessarily follows if you think that all people have to believe the same thing and do the same thing. Okay? And I think that one of the things that we see, and it's worth reflecting on in terms of our discussion about other religions and tolerance, is there's another way to think about this as an affirmation of human difference. And so I'm going to mention here Jonathan Sacks, who wrote a very good book wrote so many good books, but the book I particularly like is a book called The Dignity of Difference. And Jonathan Sacks used to be the chief rabbi of Great Britain. And I think he really sums up very well this perspective, understood in its most positive sense. So this is a quote, quote, "Covenant tells me that my faith is a form of relationship with God, and that one relationship does not exclude others. Nowhere is this more magnificently set out than in the vision of Isaiah, in which the prophet sees a time in which the two great historical enemies of Israel's past, Egypt and Assyria, will one day become God's chosen alongside Israel itself." And this is a quotation from Isaiah, quote, "In that day, Israel will be the third, along with Egypt and Assyria, a blessing on earth. The Lord Almighty will bless them, saying, 'Blessed be Egypt, my people, Assyrians, my handiwork, and Israel, my inheritance,'" end quote. So far, from Sacks's point of view, far from rejecting universalism in favor of a kind of narrow particularity, this idea of the dignity of difference, this Jewish idea of difference, according to Sacks, is an occasion not for disparaging other people, but appreciating the dignity and the difference of others. Okay, so one way we can understand this is that part of what Sacks is trying to argue is that it's not about particularity versus universalism, but it's about universalizing particularity, saying that there really are differences among human beings, but this is something that we can appreciate and learn from others. So let me bring together, just for a minute, Judaism's view of other religions and apostasy. And I want to just emphasize that this idea of the dignity of difference is a theological value, as I've just tried to express, but it's also been a political value or a political ideal because, as mentioned, Judaism has mostly historically been a religious and political minority and a not very popular one at that. And so as an often oppressed minority, this idea of the dignity of difference is a political ideal as well in the way in which Jews should be able to be Jewish and remain different along with the differences of others. So let me conclude by coming back once again just to this idea of sovereignty and say that I certainly think that there are ways in which this idea of religion as individual conscience and the modern nation state can be reconciled from a Jewish point of view. I've mentioned just two people this evening who did that, or three people actually, if we include Geiger, Mendelssohn, Geiger, and Sacks. Mendelssohn and Sacks are actually traditionalists, so it's not just liberal versus non-liberal, but also traditionalists. So that's certainly possible. But I think something that might be very important for us to do is to turn our gaze away also from this question of, can Judaism, in this sense, be tolerant? And ask the question about how tolerant can the nation state actually be? How much difference is the nation state really able to contain within it? And that strikes me as one of the most pressing issues that we face today in the world. And I look forward to our discussion. Thank you very much.
You forgot your water. Very thought-provoking and inspiring talk and fascinating insights into Jewish perspectives, plural, on the issue of religious freedom. Professor Avner Emon will now present the Islamic viewpoints on the same issue, but before he does so and before he gets his water as well, allow me to introduce him to you briefly, and I'm very honored to do that. You are a professor and Canada Research Chair in Religion, Pluralism, and the Rule of Law at the University of Toronto. And Avner Emon research focuses on pre-modern and modern Islamic legal history and theory, and the role of the Sharia both inside and outside the Muslim world. I hope I'm all correct what I'm saying. His general academic interests include topics in law and religion, legal history, and legal philosophy. He teaches distorts constitutional law and statutory interpretation and offers specialized seminars on Islamic legal history, gender and Islamic law, and law and religion. He is recipient of numerous research grants and was named as a 2014 Guggenheim Fellow in the field of law. And amongst his most important publications, one should mention Islamic Natural Law Theories, Oxford University Press, 2010, and Religious Pluralism and Islamic Law, Dimis and Others in the Empire of Law, Oxford University Press, 2012. He has also worked extensively on the questions related to human rights and Islam, and which is reflected in his volume, Islamic Law and International Human Rights Law, Searching for Common Ground. Again, Oxford, 2012. And now, Professor Emon, we're really forward hearing your talk. You also get a glass of water. I wish I had enough water for the whole audience, but we have to wait for that a bit. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much. It's a pleasure to be here today. I want to thank the Jewish Museum of Berlin and all of its staff for inviting me and allowing me to come and making it possible for me to be here today. I have prepared some statements because I tend to talk too fast. And with the translators back there, I want to be respectful of them because they have the hardest job here. So please tell me. So I hope that they'll tell me if I'm going too fast. A few days ago, the province that I live in, Ontario in Canada, elected what many are calling Canada's Donald Trump, campaigning on a platform that is anti-poor, anti-religious difference, and misogynistic. The one positive thing he offered was beer for a dollar, which, given the value of the Canadian dollar, is probably 50 cents for your euro. The angry white male rural voter was his targeted audience, and he won a parliamentary majority. It would seem that all around the world, we're seeing a turn to right-wing conservative, if not neo-fascist, political leaders who bemoan a crisis of decay that they all too often associate, if not blame on, religious and racial difference. The recent measures in Austria against mosques, France's targeting of what Muslim women wear, Saudi Arabia's restrictions on pretty much every non-Muslim, Burmese Buddhists on Rohingya Muslims, Egypt's restrictive restrictions on Coptic Christians, as well as violent campaigns against the Muslim Brotherhood, all of these represent instances in which the state performs its governmental function in part by targeting those who are different and who also happen to be some of the most vulnerable in those societies. Rather than indulge some metaphorical ideal of civilization or the West or the Muslim world, it would seem more analytically precise for us to say that what we're seeing is the coercive power of the state working through its faceless bureaucracy upon the bodies of those whose distinctiveness as individuals is made to stand for more than just themselves. The face of the targeted is made to represent threat, however unclear, undefined, or fantastical. Indeed, the sense of threat is pervasive, to which, once accepted, a quite understandable response to threat is, of course, enhanced security. It may be that the sense of threat is illusory, but once belief in that threat takes shape, we shouldn't be surprised at the response. We might say that even if the belief is little more than paranoia or conspiracy, it almost doesn't matter. Why? Perception need not be empirically verifiable. As a law professor, I often tell my law students that the law must be neutral in fact, but also in perception. It must be perceived to be neutral. There's a difference, I tell them, at least analytically, between the factual neutrality of the legal system, which we as lawyers, judges, must ensure, but there's also a reality to the perception of neutrality. The perception of neutrality anticipates a range of political commitments we make as a society to each other to ensure all of us are equal before the law. Without that perception, that popular perception of neutrality, public faith in the institution of law will falter, leaving only electoral politics to change the regime, lest revolution occur. So it's this distinction between perception and reality, between perceived threat and institutional security measures, that I want to begin my remarks on the Islamic legal approach to religious diversity. And I should preface by saying I am focusing on the law side of things. I'm going to reserve the theological questions perhaps for the Q&A session, and you'll understand what I mean when I get to the legal issues. In the field of Islamic studies, scholars often rely on the analytic concept of tolerance to address the question of Islam and religious diversity. Is Islam or Islamic law tolerant of other religious traditions? Some say no, it is not tolerant. They point to the various rules that regulated non-Muslim permanent residents in Muslim lands. Those rules are called in Arabic the Ahkam al-Dhimma, or the Dhimmi rules. Others, however, will say that these rules were mere academic fluff written by jurists in the ivory tower and have little to say to the reality of the medieval everyday. Between, of course, these two extremes are a whole host of positions that take shape in different contexts, in different periods of time, over different regions. I want to suggest to you, however, that the language of tolerance misses the point, and it was, as a result, skews the analysis. Tolerance presumes that there is an us and a you. Us and you live together in a shared polity, but the culture and values of that polity reflects those held by the majority of us, not the minority of you. In fact, some of the values that you have might actually seem a little ridiculous to the us. But having said that, so the theory goes, we will nonetheless tolerate you. We will allow you scope of freedom to do your weird things, express your weird values, and not punish you. This is the paradigm of tolerance, a paradigm that hides the conditions and contingencies of power, domination, and the prerogatives of the governing authority. It's not that we should discard tolerance as if meaningless. Tolerance, indeed, has an important role to play in our conversation. My point, though, is that debates on tolerance indulge in an either-or binary, when in fact tolerance is really about a sliding scale of imprecise line drawing. My worry about tolerance as a concept is that it presumes a binary. We either do or we do not tolerate. Tolerance on this model becomes a zero-sum game that does not allow for the fact that the we might tolerate you in some areas, but not others. What tolerance hides, in other words, is the messy business of governing in a context of diversity. We see this messy business across time and space. We see it here in Europe, and more locally, I'm aware of it also in Germany. For instance, I'm aware in Germany that students in class often have to take religious instruction, either in Protestant, Catholic, or Jewish study. The extent to which we might see other courses for other religious traditions will depend on a range of considerations that reflect the demographic shifts in society, the challenges of developing new curricula, training qualified personnel, and of course, funding for new public school officials. I argue that we also see this kind of messiness in the treatment of non-Muslims under Islamic law. I should first clarify what I mean by the non-Muslim under Islamic law. There are a lot of ways in which the historical tradition of Islamic law, and here I'm referring to the 9th and 15th century legal writings among Muslim jurists, predominantly within the Sunni tradition. The non-Muslim in that tradition might be a foreigner to Islamic lands who is presumed an enemy combatant unless a treaty exists between the foreigners' people, and the Islamic regime. It could be that the non-Muslim is actually in Muslim lands, but only temporarily, perhaps a merchant traveling around to sell his wares in Muslim lands. His stay may be temporary, and as such, he's subject to a range of limits that are commonplace when we think analogically about basic immigration reform and visitors, visas, things like that. But then there's the non-Muslim who resides permanently in Islamic lands. This is the person, the dhimmi, who occupies the position of the religious minority in a manner most relatable to the questions posed of me today. And it's this permanent resident, the dhimmi, this is the person I'm thinking about when I'm asked, what is the attitude of Islamic law towards religious minorities? Muslim jurists writing from the 9th to 15th centuries across the Sunni schools of Islamic law adopted a range of strategies concerning the non-Muslim permanent resident. At the core of their analysis was what they called the contract of protection, or in Arabic, the Aqda Dhimma. This contract, jurists argued, defined the terms of agreement between the non-Muslim permanent resident and the Muslim polity. Now let me be clear, there was no actual formal contract that you signed. Jurists used the idea of a contract as a kind of trope to capture the reciprocal obligations and duties between the dhimmis, as residents in Muslim lands, and Muslim rulers who had governing authority over them. The contract offered an ideal type, or an analog by which jurists could debate what it meant to govern a distinctively Islamic polity that also had non-Muslims as its inhabitants. For them, there was a paradox in this situation. The Islamic polity's reason for existence, its justification politically and theologically, was to spread the universal message of Islam. It seemed odd to some jurists that this universal message and the imperative of expansion that it made evident would nonetheless make room for those who ignored that universal message or simply outright rejected it, considering it false. The non-Muslim dhimmi, in order to reside within the Muslim polity, had to pay a special poll tax to enter this contract, and in a sense, literally buy in into the terms of the Muslim polity. Think of a contract. There's an offer, there's an exchange, and there's a price payment when you go to a store. In many ways, contract becomes the organizing device, and of course, taxation. The Quranic basis for this poll tax exists in chapter 9, verse 29 of the Quran, which states, "Fight those who have received revelation and who do not believe in God or the hereafter. Do not prohibit what God and his messenger have prohibited, and do not follow the religion of truth until they pay the jizya from their hands in a state of submission." This last phrase, state of submission, in Arabic reads, wahum sahirun. This notion of being in a state of submission suggests an Islamic imperative of domination, if not outright intolerance. That's certainly a fair first reading one could give. But as I've argued elsewhere, the legal debates about the dhimmi rules were a debate about the terms of that contract of protection. And what we can see in the range of debates is that there is no single strategy jurists adopted toward the non-Muslim permanent resident. The strategies that they adopted varied, ranging from accommodation to outright subordination. For example, it is commonly known so I'm going to give you a couple examples just to illustrate what it looked like as a medieval jurist to think about these issues. It's commonly known that Muslims are prohibited from consuming alcohol, at least so the law goes. You would expect that there would be a general prohibition of it within an Islamic imperial polity. But the general rule prohibiting alcohol consumption did not apply to the dhimmi. Rather, to accommodate the dhimmis and their religious tradition, which was a term of the contract, the responsibility of the Muslim polity was to make space for the dhimmi in the performance of their religious tradition. So Muslim jurists said that, well, with respect to alcohol, they assumed, well, their tradition allows it, so we should give them an exemption. So if you're a Dhimmi living in Islamic imperial Baghdad, go ahead and have your dollar beer. That's okay. And so not only could you have your beer, but you could also sell it. It was lawful property that you could transact in with each other. But what's interesting, though, is that this general prohibition, though exempted for the Dhimmi, allowed jurists to infer something broader about the polity they were creating. Yes, it's an Islamic polity. Yes, non-Muslims reside in it. We're going to give them an exemption from this core value that we seem to focus on. But nonetheless, we still want to remind the non-Muslim that this is an Islamic polity. So what did they do? They inferred from the prohibition of alcohol consumption a public order rule. And they argued, inferentially, without any reference to scriptural text, that in addition to prohibiting alcohol consumption, you could also prohibit public drunkenness. So here we see an exemption to a general legal prohibition as a way of accommodating the non-Muslim permanent resident. But that same general prohibition informed a public policy provision to create an Islamic milieu of sorts by limiting public drunkenness. Another example poses questions about the security threat, whether real or imagined, that Dhimmis posed to the Muslim polity. This perceived threat informed legal doctrines around charity and trust doctrine. To endow property in the matter of a trust was a right that accrued to a property owner as an individual. In this context, I could entrust my property, I could put my property in a trust, and let's say the interest payments from it will be paid out to my heirs in such and such portions for as long as they live. So that's the idea of a trust, just so that we're on the same page, and you could do the same thing in Islamic law. To use one's property to create a charitable endowment, though, was often intended to influence the public weal, whether in some small or large part. As such, at the intersection of private rights of ownership and charitable bequests in trust form, jurists expressed a range of concerns about regulating philanthropic giving that might contravene the public good. Put differently, while private property rights might be protected, the scope of protection was limited in light of competing interests of a more general public nature. Consequently, the juristic debate about whether and to what extent a Dhimmi could endow a charitable trust had to account for the need that of both respecting the Dhimmi's private property rights as an individual, but also public policy concerns. So let me give you an example. Shafi'is and Hanbali jurists generally agreed that Dhimmis could create a trust and issue bequests in the interest of a specifically named individual in the trust document. I create this trust for the benefit of my child, name of whatever, or of my friend William. That's great. This permissive attitude was based on basically your respect for private property ownership and the rights the private property owner had to dispose of his or her property. But let's suppose the Dhimmi wanted to make a bequest that didn't benefit anyone in particular, no specific named person, but rather was more lofty, more abstract, such as the jurists would argue, creating a Torah or a Bible reading school. In this case, jurists were skeptical. For Shafi'i jurists in particular, these kinds of public charitable trusts might affect the Islamic milieu, the public interest. If they adversely affected the Islamic milieu of the polity, Shafi'i jurists argued, such bequests were sinful, they were sins against God, and therefore invalid. To hold otherwise would be both paradoxical and threatening. Shafi'i Muslim jurists were loath to use the legal institutions of an Islamic governing system to legitimate practices that contravened an Islamically defined public good. The Shafi'i jurist Ash-Shirazi was particularly interesting in this regard. Here's his argument around the public trust. He held that a charitable trust, at its core, is a pious endowment meant to bring one close to God. That's the first premise. Premise number two. He held that anyone who created a charitable endowment through a testamentary interest, like a will, creates an institution that is meant to create bounties for others. Think of the museum here and the way all of you are beneficiaries, though not specifically named in any deed or corporate organization. Lastly, he concluded from this that any charitable endowment that makes possible sin is not lawful, is invalid. He held that charitable endowments that support a church or a Torah reading school perpetuated disbelief in the land of Islam and therefore by were tantamount to sin. Consequently, because the bounties of such charitable endowments were sinful, the endowment deed itself was void as a matter of law. But here's where it gets interesting. He went further and analogically likened such bequests to other kinds of bequests that armed the Muslim polity's enemies, thereby equating both in terms of their potential to inflict harm on the Muslim world, on the Muslim community. In other words, for Ashirazi, a charitable endowment that supported the perpetuation of value systems that were contrary to the Islamic universalist ethos were not simply sinful and therefore legally invalid, they were security threats that had to be contained for the benefit and existence of the Islamic polity. Contrary to this approach, Hanafi jurists addressed the power to bequest using a hypothetical about a dhimmi who bequeathed his home to be a church as opposed to leaving it to a specifically named person. Abu Hanifa, the eponym for the Hanafi school, held this a completely lawful bequest on the ground that this act was pious. It was a pious devotional act for the dhimmi and must be respected just as the Muslims respected the dhimmi's faith in other regards. In other words, while both Ash-Shirazi and Abu Hanifa viewed charitable endowments as bringing one closer to God, Abu Hanifa differed in that he argued that bringing someone closer to God cannot be defined only in Islamic terms. Closeness to God takes different forms depending upon the tradition to which one belongs. And the contract of protection demanded that he see that kind of plurality of purpose. Whereas for Ash-Shirazi, the contract did not require that of him. Now, we might be tempted to say that Shafis are more conservative and Hanafis more progressive and egalitarian. We might say that implicit in these schools are certain political attitudes. However verifiable that may or may not be, I offer these examples instead to suggest that the Islamic legal treatment of non-Muslim permanent residents offers us a window to examine not only a historical period long gone, but also our own societies as we engage in a history of the present to determine the space for difference in our own times and places. The underlying political complexity of the dhimmi rules should unsettle some of our modern understandings of what is religious and what is secular, to continue a theme that Professor Batnitzky raised at the outset of her talk. When we think of inheritance and trusts and wills, property rights and so on, we often think of these in secular legal terms. We don't often see these as religious terms. I'm asking you to stand back from your secular assumptions that frame what is and isn't religious for us today. Too often, that framing of the religious is private, personal, and intimate. We perpetuate this reductive view of the religious even these days when it's clear the personal is not private or intimate, but indeed made to be public and open to all for scrutiny. The well-being of whole states is premised on coming to terms with whether a certain group's religious belief system is dangerous or threatening. If we acknowledge that secularism has always been a project in becoming and is less and less taken for granted today, we can come to the second question about apostasy more robustly. The second question I've been asked to address concerns conversion from Islam to another faith or to no faith at all. This question took on a certain kind of poignant reality in Canada in 2006 as the government was helping to rebuild Afghanistan. In that year, an Afghan man, Mr. Abdul Rahman, was tried in an Afghan court for having converted to Christianity and thereby apostatizing from Islam. In a country that embraces no religion, his conversion should not have been a problem. However, as a constitutional matter, Abdul Rahman's apostasy presented a capital case for the newly established Afghan democracy in light of its commitments to an Islamic constitutional vision in which none of its laws could violate Islamic law, including presumably the rules on apostasy from Islam. In the particular case of Mr. Abdul Rahman, the court found him insane and therefore not criminally responsible to stand trial for apostasy. But that legal finding only evades the larger question that was posed to me today. Is there a place for religion, for freedom of religion, including to be free from religion in Islamic law? This very question assumes we all agree on what religion is and its status within a liberal society. Our frame of reference for what religion is depends on how we understand what falls within the domain of the secular, both in terms of its scope and scale. For many, matters, as I've said, of inheritance are purely secular. We create wills and trusts and use doctrines imported from the law of obligations, which takes its inspiration from Emperor Justinian rather than God. When we understand religious freedom, we cannot help but locate ourselves within a liberal tradition in which the freedom we are concerned about is the individual's freedom, and the threat to that freedom we are worried about is the modern state. The question for me is whether these underlying concepts, the individual and the state, can be easily presumed of the pre-modern Islamic legal tradition. In some sense, they are bases by which to suggest that there are rough analogs. We know that pre-modern jurists were concerned with protecting the claims of individuals to their property and contract expectation values. We know that they were worried about the kinds of tax policies a Muslim regime would impose upon its subjects and whether that tax regime would incentivize or disincentivize productivity. But we cannot ignore that pre-modern Muslim jurists understood Islam as a public ethos of the regime. While religious minorities could organize their religious affairs with some degree of accommodation, those religious differences nonetheless needed to be managed in a polity whose organizing ideal took the form of various commitments to principles of Islam. It's hard, therefore, to see apostasy in the liberal enlightenment terms that we all too often see it today. Rather, we must understand apostasy in the Islamic tradition in light of the public and private role that faith and belief played in the very formation of that society's law and public life. Apostasy was not merely a matter of private, intimate religion. It was a statement of loyalty, of citizenship, of belonging. To apostatize from Islam in an Islamic polity was to decry your belonging, your loyalty, your citizenship, in a sense. It was, in short, tantamount to treason, which, if left unchecked, would at the very least give the impression of a weak regime, a regime in decline, a regime under threat, however fantastic or paranoid that medieval impression might be. We have, it seems, come back full circle to the politics of perception and the prerogatives of the state and other forms of ruling regimes to exert their coercive force in the name of security and well-being, however illusory the perceived threat. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, both very thought-provoking and very inspirational thoughts you have brought into our museum space or the academy space. Maybe one question first in relation to to the museum. What do you think about this format of having this Jewish Muslim dialogue and of course this wonderful series within a museum space? Is it for you a different space than the academic university one. Could you maybe?
Okay, is that?
Yeah.
Okay. Well, again, I genuinely mean it. Thank you for the opportunity. I think it's, I'll say two things. Is one, I think in terms of having a dialogue here in this context, in Germany, in Europe, I think it's a wonderful opportunity. As I mentioned, I think many of the questions that are being asked about Islam today, when we think about Judaism and Jewish experience in Europe for, you know, I'll even go 400 years at this point, in terms of thinking about these issues with a modern state. I think there is such a long history of conversation, and one of the things that I think is really important is that there's so many different Jewish responses to these questions. It's not that there's one monolithic Jewish response, and I think that that suggests a real richness for conversation. I think the second thing in terms of a museum, I think it's wonderful, but something that's, it may be a museum and it's maybe, I think it's wonderful to be in a context where I think the relevance of these issues doesn't need to be argued for. And so that is partially the museum, and I think it's also partially being in Berlin.
You want to respond?
Yes, so I actually think it's important, specifically in North America and in Western Europe, where the notion of being a minority is a shared experience of both the Jewish and the Muslim community. And thereby having a conversation between the two is also an opportunity to put into stark relief the shadows that hover over both. It could be the state, it could be notions of culture, it could be trade wars, it could be whatever, right? But the idea then is that from these minority positions, where in various instances and across different periods, these groups have been or are on the margins, it creates an opportunity to question the center and forces us to see value in the margin. And so one of the things that I try to talk about in these contexts is to own the margin, to celebrate the margin as a vantage point from which to think about the society in which you live. And these kind of conversations are the start of that kind of reclaiming of the margin.
That's it's almost empowering, mm-hmm. I would say. Thank you so much. I thought that we would first talk among us a bit on the stage, and then I give the microphone to the public, and then we can start a more broader conversation. So it's not that we will hijack the whole evening. Don't worry. For me, it's interesting because you represent not only a Muslim and Jewish perspective, but a very law, philosophical context, and you coming from Jewish studies and religion, so that in itself is also very inter and multidisciplinary. Actually, you ended your input with sort of questioning the nation state, and I was wondering if you could elaborate a bit more on that, and if you then would respond, because we both heard your question.
Okay, well, thank you. I should say, first of all, that I think there are problems with the nation state. That said, I do strongly believe it's the best possibility we have. You know, as Winston Churchill said about democracy, it's the worst form of government, except everything else is worse. So similarly, I think about the state. I don't want to deny the importance of the rule of law and the opportunities and the greater rights that the modern state has brought. But I think that the question of how much a state can tolerate minorities is, I think, a pressing question. And we're talking here, yes, from the margins, but I think it's really important to recognize that we're always talking about people. And so it's not a question of, say, I'll speak in my case, you know, sort of Judaism as a minority is good, But you know, when whoever is the majority is often put in a situation where they will press their power, and they will be wanting a kind of hegemony and a kind of people being the same. And I think that's just one of the real tensions that we live with as human beings, and that we live with in terms of the state. But I think that I don't want to sound overly positive about the United States, because I think we have lots of problems, as should be evident. Really major problems, to say the least. That said, I do think that something that's different about the United States has historically been its recognition that there are many ways of being American, and that hyphenate, being an American Jew or an American Muslim or an American Christian, doesn't take away from your American identity. I'm not, and so I think that's very important. I think that's been a very important experiment. That said, and I don't want to downplay this in any way, I think we're living at a time when that's really being called into question, and that's one of the great potential threats and tragedies of what's going on now. Nevertheless, I think that that's a very important ideal. But that's probably, but even in the United States, again, you see, for all of that, what we have developing there now, and I think this is unfortunately just an ever-present human threat to want to deny difference, and it's something we just very much have to guard against.
Would you like to respond to that?
So one of the things that I think about, so keep in mind that I'm a law professor. When I think of the state, I think of the legal powers of the state. I think of the adjudicatory powers of the judge. I think of tax policy, which I happen to find quite fascinating, which we can talk about another time. But what has struck me as absent in the academic context, and which I fear trickles down and across and in different ways, is that we treat the state monotheistically or theologically like a sovereign god, but we don't actually break it down. And one of the things that I think about with respect to the state is that whereas oftentimes we think of the state as a singular entity, it's really quite complicated. It's really quite messy. It's quite contradictory. It's quite incoherent at times. Sometimes it's compassionate. Sometimes it's utterly ridiculous. And so part of what I think we need to think about with respect to the state is what are the best or more effective ways to think about it? I happen to use law as a way of getting at it. And the law then begins to reflect certain kinds of cultures of the state. And we've talked a little bit about that. National security policy, immigration law, these are distinct spaces of state activity, but they also reflect certain kinds of cultural values. And what I would simply suggest is that adopting a position on the margin allows us to see the cultural content of what's passed off as neutral. So I would, like Professor Batnitzky, suggest that the state is our effective vehicle for managing bureaucratically really complex social lives. My worry, though, is that in its claim to coercive monopoly, it tends to force order rather than enable disorder to coexist. And perhaps locating moments of productive disorder is one of the things that we can also think about doing.
It's almost a manifesto. I would like to go back to the content of your talk, and maybe ask some questions, because you said some of the issues you would like to reflect upon in the question and answers, the Q&A. Proselytism and Islam, like Christianity, Islam is a missionary religion, meaning that spreading the faith is one of the most important tasks to which believers, all believers, maybe are called. And how can a balance be struck between this commandment and affirming freedom of religions and conscience. That would be something that I'm very interested in. And how can fundamental criticism of missionary activity can be countered again in a sort of activist approach, maybe? Well, we are dropping things tonight.
Well, I think it's a. I think one has to think about how the universal message that is the Islamic message takes shape in early Islamic history mechanically through conquest, through empire. And one can't help when reading medieval legal sources to see that although jurists that I study don't talk about empire or imperialism, that's the underlying assumption that informs how they envision the law. So let me give you a simple example. It comes out of what in Europe you would call private international law. Basically, when can a court take jurisdiction of a case? So let's, for Muslim jurists, they divided the world into the abode of Islam and the abode of war. That was the jihad doctrine. Now we think of this in militant, militaristic terms. I want to suggest instead that we look at these terms, the abode of Islam and the abode of war, differently. Let's think about them as the domestic and the foreign. And the question then becomes, when should a domestic court in Islamic lands enforce a foreign judgment? Simple. We do this all the time. In the United States, when it comes to Islamic law, we have Sharia bans in the context of these foreign law rules. You can adjudicate foreign law all the time. Courts do it. If you're in Germany and you have a case that where a contract takes shape in Spain, the Spanish law will govern the contract potentially. And a German court can adjudicate that in its various ways. But in medieval Islamic law, if you had a court, if you had a case from foreign lands, you never took jurisdiction. You never heard the case. You never allowed an Islamic court in the Islamic lands to adjudicate foreign law because it would be undignified. So the question then for us is, how do you separate a universal message from the historical conditions of imperialism that animated later developments around mechanizing that universal message? And this is where Professor Batnitzky and I can have really interesting conversations, because with her and other colleagues of mine who work in rabbinic studies, one sees the implication of these imperial assumptions when you contrast an Islamic imperial ideal with rabbinic tradition developed under the assumptions of diaspora.
Do you want to respond to that?
Sure, thank you. I do think that these questions about diaspora versus empire are extremely extremely important. I guess I did want to say one thing in the context of Judaism. I mean, because I think the flip side of this question about missionizing, and I think it's a very, very important question, in the contemporary context for Judaism, is that there's a way in which we talked about apostasy here, and I talked a little bit about conversion, but one of the really interesting things in terms of converting to Judaism today that's really changed in terms of the state of Israel is actually that it's become harder to convert to Judaism, and it's become a way in which a majority in that context is actually much more controlling and stifling of internal Jewish difference. Now the point...
Because I don't know if everybody in the public is so in depth in that particular subject. Maybe you can use a few sentences to give some more context.
Sure. Well, in Israel, this has to do. There is no constitution in Israel. There was always supposed to be a constitution. I'm not sure if some people are still waiting for it. Doesn't seem to be happening. One reason that there was no constitution was that there was a deal struck right before the state was established between David Ben-Gurion, the first prime minister, who became the first prime minister, and the ultra-Orthodox, where Ben-Gurion basically said, if you join us, we'll let you basically be in charge of all religious things. And they said, okay, and each side thought that the other side would die out. That didn't happen, and one of the results in Israel is that the ultra-Orthodox or the religious Zionists, depending who it is, but that there is, the state gives them authority to make decisions about marriage and about conversion. And so one of the things that happens in that context, which I think is directly relevant here, is that I emphasized in my talk how, well, on the issue of apostasy, you see that there is a kind of recognition of difference. But one of the things that happens when you have a majority is that there are far stricter controls put on in terms of who can be in and who can't be in. And again, I want to emphasize this is a human thing. I don't think this is an issue of, in this sense, this tradition versus that tradition. In many ways, when you're a minority, there's an opportunity to actually be have some kind of more internal difference than when you are a majority. And I think that's one of the things that we see happening in the state of Israel. It's very interesting, the conversion policies that go on in the state of Israel for lots of reasons. If I may just give one other example.
Please do.
So one of the things I emphasized here was how if, you know, based on the Talmud and the Shulchan Aruch, which is the major medieval Jewish code, and you really can't do better in terms of pedigree for texts than that. The emphasis is that a convert, so once someone's converted to Judaism, no matter what they do, they're still a Jew. One of the things that's been really interesting in terms of the Jewish world is that in Israel, the people in charge of conversions actually now annul conversions. Okay, and so they say, well, you converted, but you didn't, you know, do this and that, or you did do this and that, and now you're no longer Jewish. And one of the things that's just extremely interesting is that that's completely in tension with, if not direct contradiction, to the entire tradition. But it's another example of what happens when you switch from, I think, a minority to a majority. And that this is just internally. We're not even talking about in terms of non-Jews here. We're just talking about internally, and I think that this kind of question of diasporic or majority, I'll just call it for lack of a better term, I think is one of the most central issues in thinking about these things. So it shouldn't just be a question, say, of this religion versus liberal ideals. It really is, I think, so much a matter of particular contexts and particular power dynamics.
I see a new lecture series coming up here for next year. Maybe, and that's a question to both of you, not freedom of religion, but freedom of conscience, which I think is a different thing. How much personal autonomy can both Judaism and Islam afford the individual to exercise freedom of conscience?
So there's two ways I want to approach the question. So one is to think about the phrase itself. We see it like in the European Convention of Human Rights, as Professor Batnitzky had up. Yeah, you had Article 9. I always find the subsection of Article 9 most interesting. If you go back and look at Article 9 of the European Convention, it articulates the protection of freedom and conscience. But the subsection right after it says, we get to limit manifestation. Manifestation can be limited in certain contexts, depending upon, usually it's things like what's necessary for a free and democratic society, and in the interests of national security. Now, what a lot of law and religion scholars have identified is that this distinction between conscience and manifestation works really well for Protestants, not so much for Jews and Muslims. And there is a way in which you can tie in limitations on headscarves, kosher and halal butcheries into this manifestations category and thereby limit it. And the question then, the limit on the manifestation is there's no one saying, the government says, yes, we are limiting your religious freedom, but we are justified in doing so. And it's the justification that speaks culturally to the meaning of that state, that gives a cultural meaning to that notion of religious freedom. So it's in that context that it's not surprising you see similar kinds of patterns also in medieval Islamic laws. So when it comes to the freedom to practice, you certainly have, with respect to the dhimmis, a scope of freedom, but it's restricted. So if I'm a Christian in Muslim lands and I want to ring the church bell, can I do that? Or does that become nuisance law? Suddenly is that a noise pollution? We were talking about noise pollution the other day. When does that, how does that get regulated? How loud is too loud, right? And so there are a variety of restrictions in that context. But it should also be recognized, and one of the things that I was intrigued about in your slide on the apostate who leaves, both of the provisions you had on there said that the marriage remains valid. Mm. Now, this was interesting to me, because if a Muslim, so first, so this is a marital rule issue. Muslim women are presumed as a matter of law only to marry Muslim men. They are prohibited from marrying non-Muslim.
And how is that with men?
Men are allowed to marry outside, both Muslim women and non-Muslim women, but non-Muslim women should be people of the book, which means Jews or Christians. So let's suppose that you have a husband and wife who are Muslim, but the man, husband, apostatizes. In that context, Islamic law will say the marriage is invalid. And we have examples of these kinds of things used for political purposes in the Muslim world in the 1990s. But what was interesting is that when we talk about freedom of conscience, we oftentimes link it to the individual. And what the examples around marriage remind us is that religious belief wasn't about just the individual. It was about a network. It was about community. Mm. There was a strong communitarian orientation, which is the way by which I think both of us are trying to question the liberal individual ideals of secularism by saying these two traditions were, on the one hand, they were traditions of value, they were systems of law, but they were also ways of seeing the world. And the notion of freedom of conscience there's a place, but it's also a very awkward place.
Would you like to reflect on this awkward space as well? I would be honored.
Oh, sure. Well, I think it's really the question, and it's very tricky. I mean, on the one hand, I'd say from a Jewish perspective, there's as much freedom as of conscience as you want, if it's a matter of thinking about what you want to think. You can think whatever you want. I mean, Moses Mendelssohn, who I mentioned, made, I think, probably the strongest argument. It's probably overly argued, I should say, but that you don't have to actually believe in anything. Or you don't have to believe particular things. You do have to believe in something. You don't have to believe particular things. You have to always follow the law. But the law, its meaning changes. You have to do it. But he wanted to argue more so that the law, you know, this is how we have these changes interpretations. So, yes, you can think whatever you want, but you still have to follow the law. But this raises exactly the question that was just raised. But let me mention one other thing, is that it's also not clear in a modern context who's really in charge of enforcing it. So when we ask this question, how much is allowed of X, Y, or Z, we have to ask according to whom. And so there's a lot of internal Jewish difference. I mean, there's really not one Judaism. There are many Judaisms. And today, I think historically there was one Judaism to some extent, though. I guess that's debatable. But today there are many, many, and so who's going to enforce it? And one reason why I think some communities, Jewish communities, have become so much stricter or in so much less tolerant is because they're trying to differentiate themselves from other Jewish communities. So technically speaking, from a kind of halachic or perspective of religious law, it doesn't matter if, say, for Judaism, it goes by the mother, except for in liberal Judaism, also the father, but let's just say the mother for a moment. But if a woman had a child and then she converted to Christianity, the child would still be Jewish from a halakhic perspective. Yet, I think this is where you get into questions about this annulling conversions that I mentioned before, because it's, if someone's a conversion is annulled, that means their children are no longer Jewish. And there are all kinds of things. In fact, there people have got some rabbinic authorities have gone back and annulled, you know, people who are no longer living, you know, somebody's grandmother's conversion. And so this is where you get into to these questions about whose authority and why are some communities becoming so much less tolerant, we'll use for lack of a better term, given the fact that historically speaking, we actually see that there's a lot of flexibility here. And one main reason is because they're competing with other Jewish communities, and they want to you know maintain. That's one way of maintaining authority.
Before you maybe want to respond to that, I would, because you mentioned Moses Mendelssohn, I would like to give you a museological compliment, because I really like the fact that you were using objects of our collection. That's you stay a museum, so that's nice. Do you want to directly respond?
I just say one small thing about that. I just want an appreciation of the Jewish Museum. I studied all these German Jewish thinkers, and one of the most exciting things for me, not this time, but previously when I've come here, is to see you've got all of the originals of the paintings. And so I appreciate that. It's not just Moses Mendelssohn and Abraham Geiger, but you've got the, if some of you may know, Herman Cohen's book, Religion of Reason, Out of the Sources of Judaism. There's a picture of a painting on there. You've got the original painting. I appreciate it. So thank you.
We have a wonderful collection. Yes. Thank you. Going back to our discussion. Yeah,
so I think this issue of authority is really important, because it's also about when, what is the line between when your freedom is yours versus when it begins to be a matter of public concern. So let's go back to Islamic discourses on apostasy. If I'm a Muslim and I just decide I don't really believe in this stuff anymore, and I keep it to myself, no witnesses, no one to prove it, there's no liability, at least not in this life, before any courts in this world. And so there's a way in which my conscience is mine until I begin to be open about it, maybe even a jerk about it, right? If I'm being rude and obnoxious, like, yeah, this Islam stuff's nasty business, I'm so glad I'm done with it, and I go around in Islamic polity, well, people are going to get pretty upset. I'm going to become a public nuisance. And this is where, you know, issues of conscience, we so easily call them private, but they also have very significant public implications. And it's in these moments when the apostate or the apostasy becomes public that the anxiety of the society is enshrined in this rule. So I simply wanted to mention that the rule itself is thinking a lot about the public weal, the salus populi in Latin, I guess, is what Enlightenment scholars would call. But then it does also beg the question, well, who's going to enforce it? How many witnesses do you need? Who's going to carry out the execution sentence? All of these become mechanized questions for putting that rule into action, all of which were debated, but all of which have so many safeguards built in procedurally that it becomes very difficult to actually prosecute.
One last question to you both before we open the discussion to the floor. Polytheism or non-theism, how do Judaism and Islam view non-monotheistic, non-theistic worldviews and religions? Religions which are not religions of the book, you already shortly were referring to it in the case of marrying a non Islam or Muslim woman. What is the Jewish perspective on that?
Well, of course, big question, and many, if there are Jewish studies people in the audience, everyone will correct me on anything I'm about to say. But
then we have a good discussion.
But I think as a general rule, I'd say I don't think there is the same kind of special place for Christianity and Islam as opposed to polytheism in Judaism. I think I mentioned Maimonides, and he did stress, right, that there is the shared biblical text. So yes, there's one aspect, and there are other Jewish thinkers who have done that. There are Jewish thinkers who have really favored Islam because they see it as far more monotheistic. But I don't think that they have a special status as sort of people of the book in that sense. And I think the question about polytheism, we do get to this issue of idolatry, but where I just mentioned in passing Josephus and Philo, in the context where there are pagan cults, et cetera, is that they even make the arguments that, well, they might look like they're pagan, but they're really not. And I'll mention just Moses Mendelssohn once more. One of the lines he has at the end of Jerusalem is when he talks about the conquerors of Jerusalem, connected to the exhibit, the conquerors of Jerusalem, and they saw the cherubim in the temple. And they saw them as idols, Mendelssohn says. But he says that's because the eyes of barbarians, he says, can only see idols. So the point that he's making there is that what we call idols depends so much on our own cultural references that what we have to understand, I'll give you the end of what Mendelssohn said, instead of signs that have to be interpreted. So what we call idols, or what we call something that's very reductive, doesn't necessarily reflect the internal workings of a religious system. So I think, again, that's Mendelssohn's argument. I mean, I think that I wouldn't want to say that there is a definition from the beginning of all polytheism being idolatrous in that sense. It will always, I think, depend on particular contexts.
So in the Islamic context, historically, you can certainly see a hierarchy of non-believers. There's the people of the book, the Jews and the Christians. There's the Magians, who are oftentimes referenced, who we think were Persian Zoroastrians. Then there's the polytheists, the idol worshippers, the Abdat al-Awthan. Now, from a theological perspective, we have to account for the fact that polytheism gets very harshly treated, in large part because the Mecca in which the prophet was raised was polytheist. So the Islam he preached was preached in opposition to that polytheism. So they don't come off very well, theologically speaking. But the lawyer in me also wants to say, the lawyer in me is mindful that ideals are always subject to compromise, and so, as I always teach my students, follow the money. So when you follow the Islamic expansion, like any forms of expansion, you want land to be productive, you want to secure tax revenue. And you can't do it if you kill all the non-believers. You don't have an effective labor force. You don't have local knowledge of crop rotations. And so there is a pragmatic side reflected in the law that recognizes that we can, one, hierarchize among non-Muslims with the people of the book at the top, our model minorities, so to speak, and then the rest. And they frame this in the context legally as who can be a dhimmi, who has the ability to enter into this special status as non-Muslims. And they basically said, well, people of the book are most capable and most able. They're the most robust than me. They get the most rights within the context of this contract of protection. Well, but what about the others? What about if I'm a Zoroastrian or I'm a polytheist in India? Because remember, by 7th and 8th century, Muslims were out in India. And they said, well, okay, they can be dhimmis and pay the poll tax, but Muslims are not allowed, Muslim men, remember, who can marry non-Muslim women. They can only marry the women who are members of the people of the book. You can't marry as a man a polytheist woman or a a Magian or a Zoroastrian. So that's one, so limiting kinship networks. And two, you can in terms of eating your dietary restrictions around what is and isn't halal, Muslims can eat the meat slaughtered by Christians and Jews, but not anyone else outside of those categories. Trade restrictions, in this context of trade wars, there was basically, they wanted to maintain a certain kind of balance of trade in the context of meat and cultivation. So what you have then is this hierarchy that is theologically organized, but takes legal shape in the context of kinship, taxation, and market.
Maybe it's too simple, but could you also give a contemporary example? Because you talk about Moses Mendelssohn, and you were referring to the Mughal dynasties. This modern views on polytheism and in Judaism.
Well, thanks. I think the polytheism is not such a big issue for Judaism today. I think one of the we're Jews thinking today. I don't think that's actually much of an issue at all.
Well, I know a lot of also congregations that sort of are slightly Buddhist and do Zen Zen Buddhistic exercises, but also are a Jewish community.
Yeah, no, and I think that's quite common, actually. I mean, I don't think that's really the issue. I mean, I think that I think there is a general view. This is in non-Orthodox circles. In non-Orthodox circles, there's a general view that yes, you can, you know, Jews can believe lots of different things, and there doesn't have to be uniformity of belief, and we can take from different traditions. And I think that the Buddhist trends, they call, there was a book in English on I think they're called Bu-Jews, like Buddhist Jews. There's a lot of all over the place, and I think that's one aspect where Jews think, well, Judaism and Buddhism have in common that they don't have these particular beliefs. I think that they're probably wrong about that in both cases, but I leave it at that.
But are there also Orthodox Bu-Jews?
Well, I think they wouldn't call them that, but I think that there is meditation. In you know, there are different kinds of orthodoxy, but in some orthodox circles, I think it's less of an issue. I mean, I think that in certain circles, in more orthodox circles, there's always a question of what is really Jewish and a discomfort with anything that seems outside. But I don't think it's directly related to polytheism. If I may just say one thing, I think what's interesting that what we see in the United States, at least, and I'm curious if this is happening in Europe, is and going to the question of context. I mentioned the German Jewish thinkers who were so interested in Islam in the Golden Age of Spain, because it was also for them a comment on the problems with their society. I do think we have more North American Jewish thinkers who are very interested in Christianity now. One of them is Professor Emon's colleague, David Novak, for instance.
Right. Yeah,
yes. Who's done a lot of work in this. And I think that there are many reasons for it. One of them does have to do with post-Vatican II Christian approaches to Jews and Judaism in terms of trying to have a dialogue. But I also think it does have to do with the politics of our contemporary world. I'm not saying it's only the politics of our contemporary world, but I think in some cases it is. So I think the way in which, say, different traditions align themselves with different traditions at different moments really changes. And so I think it's if someone were to write in the 22nd century, comparing, say, the 19th and the 20th and 21st centuries on sort of Jewish views of Islam and Christianity, you get, I think, a very different kind of picture than we have at the moment.
So on the polytheism, at least in modern times, there's two things I'd like to say. One is, I think you see it most prominently in the political controversies in India between the Hindu majority government and how it's treating its Muslim minorities. And so there, I think it takes shape in the context of a Hindu-Muslim rivalry around religious tradition. It creates tensions around the extent to which, you know, a Muslim might want to make poetic reference to the Mahabharata, the Ramayana, which are seen as Hindu texts. And that's one very clean and easy site. Where I think it also comes up, though, within the Muslim community, has to do with notions of pure Islam. Mm. So as Islam expanded its territorial reach, among the many ways by which Islam, the religious belief, was inculcated in many, was through various kinds of syncretic practices where Muslim preachers would go out, and we know this in India in the 9th, 10th, and 11th century, and you certainly see this in Muslim poetry in the 14th century, where there's a kind of fusion of Islamic ideas, Hindu ideas, is a way of also making the Islamic message palatable. And as we see this moving from India to Indonesia, you see different kinds of interactions, different kinds of notions of Islam, which has created within the Muslim community a politics of who is the better Muslim. And it speaks to a kind of Arab centrism as the site of the right, pure, and true Islam, which then gets mechanized through oil politics and the wealth that which oil wealth allows an exportation of. Yeah. So you see polytheism coming in through the back door of politics of religious purity and syncretism.
That's an whole other subject, yes. But extremely interesting. Yes. I would like now to open the floor and give you the possibility to ask questions to our wonderful speakers. And we have a wonderful colleague with a microphone. Maybe you can sort of say who you are. That's always also interesting for the speakers.
Ich verstehe nur Bahnhof. Ich stelle meine Frage auf Deutsch. Yes. Mein Englisch würde
one
Ihre
second,
Ohren
one
beleidigen.
One second. Yeah. We do a test first. If it works, does it work? Yes.
I'm hearing her over there.
Yeah. Do you hear? Okay. Super. Yeah.
Okay. Also buddhistische Juden. Das fand ich sehr interessant. Ist nicht Inhalt meiner Frage gleich, aber man soll ja mal einen Rabbiner gefragt haben, ob er an Wiedergeburt glaubt. Und hat gesagt, natürlich nicht, ich bin Rabbiner, aber vielleicht im nächsten Leben. Meine Frage ist eine andere. Da geht es um die Apostasie. Da hat es das Judentum ja recht komfortabel, die gibt es ja eigentlich gar nicht. Einmal Jude, immer Jude, unverlierbar. Und wenn er sich taufen lässt, ist er halt ein getaufter Jude. Und wenn er Muslim wird, ist er ein muslimischer Jude, je nachdem. Aber rauswerfen dürfen sie ja schon. Ich glaube, Sabbatai Zvi wäre vielleicht ein Beispiel. Es gibt auch andere. Man kann ja aus der jüdischen Gemeinde auch ausstoßen. Das Christentum kennt die Möglichkeit der Exkommunikation. Die können also auch rauswerfen, wobei die Taufe dann auch unverlierbar ist. Und jetzt komme ich zu meiner Frage an den Islam. Können Sie auch Leute rauswerfen, ohne sie gleich umzubringen?
Take this off. Okay, no, thank you for the question. And the better answer that the rabbi should have said is that there is actually reincarnation in Kabbalah, but I'll leave that on the side. Could have found that there. Certainly there is the possibility of excommunication, going back to Moses Mendelssohn, who I can't help but refer to. One of the things he argued in Jerusalem was that excommunication was not in keeping with true Judaism. Part of what that meant was that he knew that Jewish communities excommunicated people. But I think one of the interesting questions for today is who's doing the excommunicating and what does it mean? In a pre-modern context, when Jews, like everyone else, didn't have individual rights, if a Jew got excommunicated, and of course our most famous excommunicated person is Spinoza.
From Amsterdam.
From Amsterdam, yes. And that's why I always root for Holland in the World Cup, Netherlands, but maybe I shouldn't say that here. But anyway, okay.
This year we don't play in the World Cup.
All right, okay. So, but Spinoza's an interesting example. I'll say why is because anyone living a little bit before Spinoza lived in a different context, and I mean the Netherlands were very advanced at that stage, a Jew wouldn't have had anywhere to go. Unless that Jew converted to Christianity or Islam and became part of another religious community. So it's a very serious a thing to get excommunicated. But the fact that Spinoza, right, could live a relatively free life as an individual is an anticipation of what we have in the modern context. So today, yes, different Jewish communities can excommunicate their members, but what does it really mean? That person then can still become a member of another Jewish community. And by the way, if someone's excommunicated, it doesn't mean that they're not Jewish. It means that they're not allowed to participate in Jewish ritual life. The worst thing, I think, could be that they're not allowed to be buried in a Jewish cemetery. That would be pretty severe. And that might have consequences in another world. But it doesn't mean that they're not Jewish. So in short, the answer is yes, Jews historically have excommunicated Jews. Probably today still there are communities that excommunicate Jews. But it's very important to recognize that in the modern context, a person, a Jew or any other person, has the opportunity to become part of another community or part of no community. And that wasn't an option historically.
So I find it an interesting question. So in terms of addressing your specific question on the terms that you asked, generally, banishment was often a punishment, though not for apostasy, for other kinds of crimes where you could, in a sense, send someone away, right, and remove them from their kinship networks, which were always very important. And so on the one hand, the argument is, well, could you extend banishment to apostasy? Are there processes of, like, discretionary punishment? Sure, you could certainly create that. What's interesting to me, though, is, you know, the assumptions around the question is that I should be entitled to be open about my not believing in the polity that I'm a part of, in my not wanting to be I should be entitled to freely express my utter displeasure and disdain for the organizing logic of my society. And that's the underlying idea. And what you're really asking is, what is the space for dissent, right? Is there a space for dissent around our core values? And I think these are things we talk about, not just in religious traditions. I've been thinking about it in the context of how we police our democracies. So I've been fascinated, and so here I'm sort of switching gears, right? So is that, think about in the United States and Canada right now, I'm very aware that it matters who the dissenter is, racially and otherwise. If I'm an indigenous protester of an oil pipeline, I'm more likely going to be charged and arrested than if I were a white protester of the same pipeline. If I'm African American and protesting peacefully, I'm more likely going to be policed into the corner than if I were a white protester protesting something, again, peacefully. And so the questions that we have to think about for our societies that I think apostasy forces us to think about is, how much can we tolerate in the public fundamental debates on our core values without giving up our commitments to our society? So if we are committed to the state as a political form and we're committed to organizing it the way we have, what speech is out of bounds? And I want to suggest that apostasy and the execution sentence is simply one way of thinking about what's out of bounds.
Thank you. Another question?
I just want to put in a word for secularism. I was brought up in a fundamentalist Christian missionary religion. At about the age of 12, I realized that I was an atheist. I didn't believe. And I couldn't do that. You know, I couldn't stay in my community and just pretend or not let anybody know. I'm not that kind of person. So it took many years of severe suffering before I separated from my religion, which meant that I lost all people in my life in one day, my family and all my friends. And of course, I'm now very sympathetic and interested in the biographies of people who are how do you call people who leave their religion apostates? Never mind in what religion or never mind in what ideology, whether they are living in a communist party, not believing in communism or whatever, people who dissent and who stand up to their doubts and to their other opinion. And to me, secularism is something life-saving. I mean, the possibility to stand up and say what you think. And to me, it also means a further development of religion when it reaches a stage where it can have people talk about their doubts in a community without without being threatened and without losing their community. And so to me, it is really, I'm a bit scared by all this fundamentalist interpretations of what religion ever, never mind which. I don't care about that. So this is just a plaidoyer for more secularism.
Do you want to respond to that?
I'd like to. So there was a number of years ago in the province of Quebec, in Canada, where I live, there was a commission created in the context of a town that had issued a charter of values, which was really just an attack on Muslim migrants in Quebec. But what was interesting was the authors of the lead of the commission was this philosopher named Charles Taylor and historian named Gerard Bouchard. And they drafted a rather significant report that came out of that commission, at least significant for academics. The government ignored it. But what was interesting about their report was that they didn't say Quebec should or shouldn't be secular. They said there's different kinds of secularism. There's open secularism and there's closed secularism. So I want to pose this back to you and say, well, which secularism? Now, open secularism is, again, thinking about government policy towards religious communities, right? That's what we're thinking about in terms of secularism. Closed secularism is easy. Closed secularism means the government should have absolutely nothing to do with religion, period. And the government of Quebec rejected this. Why? Because they have a cross in the Legislative Assembly, which when asked to have it removed, they said no. There's a cross on Mount Royal, which is a cultural symbol, they claimed, we're not gonna remove it. Now, what was interesting was that a closed secular notion would say there's no space for these sorts of things, and you might agree with that. But they also offer this idea of open secularism, that rather than denying any state interaction with religion, rather to say the state can play an enabling role in the lives of people, many of whom have religion as a valuable form of sociality. So in a context in which civil society is on the decline, social networks are on the decline, we're all increasing our isolation from one another because we spend more time on Facebook than face to face, religious communities are one vehicle by which people interact with one another, and the state can, in an even-handed way, create space for them. So they adopted this notion of open secularism. So I would say, I don't take issue with your question, with your point, but rather my worry is that what you really mean by secularism is closed secularism. And then the question is, what are the costs of closed secularism to civil society, so much of which revolves around religious communities engaging in certain kinds of social activities? Here I think of Martin Luther King, and the civil rights movement. I think of the German education system and your endorsement at the public education system of ethics courses, your tithing system, all of that has to be removed. Your own country participates not in an open, even way, but in a partially open way in giving preferential treatment to certain churches and not others through your tax tithing system. Why? So if you're really serious about your closed secularism, you need to change that. I don't know if you want to go that far. And my worry is that a closed secularism will actually isolate people more, will not create the kinds of conditions that make places like a Jewish museum possible.
Open and closed secularism, or a reaction towards the question, or
I think I'm in agreement with both of you, if I'm understanding what you're both saying. And maybe the only thing I would add to it is that it's very important for there to be the possibility of people to exit religious communities. And that's, I think, something that the state actually can play a very positive role in. I think allowing religious communities, but also making sure that people who no longer want to be in those communities are able to build lives elsewhere. And I think that's extremely important. But I think that religious communities and the right of exit can coexist with one another.
Just a short comment on your remark in relation to the Jewish Museum. We are a state-funded secular institution, open on Saturdays, but that just as a footnote. Another question from the panel, from the floor. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you very much for your talks, first of all. I would like to pick up that question about the nation state, which both of you were raising in different ways. The story which we are often hearing, I guess, is that we have to transform a monocultural nation state into a multicultural nation state, so that the side of the political, however, remains the nation state. It remains the desired side of what it means to be, or to exercise sovereignty. But I wonder, I mean, that the nation state still, or in order to exercise this kind of sovereignty, you still have to practice certain things. You have to practice power, and you have to set people in relation to the state and subject them also to different grades of vulnerability towards the state. So I wonder if that not necessitates us to think about a decentering of the state and about alternative normative orders, and to think about violence also, state violence, not as mistakes in the appliance of state power, but rather as a constituent ingredient of what it means to practice sovereignty.
Sure, I think I can. So, couple thoughts on that. One of the things that I struggle with in my work, as I think about the medieval and the modern, is how to understand this idea of the modern state. It's more of an ideal. And there's a wonderful political scientist named Joel Migdal who writes about the state and society model. And his argument is that political scientists rely on this notion of the state that's more fictive. It's a much more complicated system. So what I would suggest, what I argue for is disaggregating the state in to support his idea, is think of the state as disaggregated. Think of the state as acting through local agencies. Think of the state as even contradicting itself. And the way that I do this is in the context of jurisdiction, right? But you could see someone like Foucault writing about this when he distinguishes between police power of the state and raison d'etat, right? Raison d'etat in the 17th century was the idea of the sovereign state maintaining its independence in relationship to others, right? A kind of prescription of the status quo as one looks outward, right? A principle against empire, right? But police power was interesting. Police power is, it comes out of the German tradition of Polizeiwissenschaft and is really about the administrative state. Now in the United States, very little is written about police power, though things are changing in the academic world. But I actually think police power is a more interesting way to think about the state, not necessarily to find an alternative to it, but rather to better understand its topography, so to speak, and how it operates in relation to itself, sometimes across purposes. And so, as an example, let's look at the United Arab Emirates. The United Arab Emirates in 2005 passed its first comprehensive family law code, drawn almost exclusively from pre-modern Hanbali legal doctrines. And it enshrines all the patriarchal stuff you can imagine, right? But around the same time, the Emir of Dubai created the Dubai International Financial Center. It's 110 acres in the city of Dubai, which for purposes of banking, finance, and real estate is controlled by the United Kingdom's English law. So on the one hand, you could say, well, the United Arab Emirates is an Islamic country, except it's not necessarily. It's not governed by Islamic law. In certain zones, it's governed by just simply UK law. And so all I want to simply suggest by this is that there is no singularity there that I can call the state. There is a state which has the ability, through its sovereign authority, to do a whole host of things, including ignore its own stuff. And I find that a more interesting way to approach the topic.
I'm sorry to say, because I could sit here for another 3 hours, but we need to leave the building at a certain point, and we also have the breaking of the fast, the last day of Ramadan, so the iftar meal I was talking about earlier. So I would like really, really wholeheartedly thank the wonderful speakers of this evening and give them a very big applause. I believe we both have a big love, which is called, which is Moses Mendelssohn. So I like that a lot. And what I take a lot with me from you both, but empowerment from the margins is something that is, I think, something that is very inspirational for me as well. So Moses Mendelssohn and empowering from the margins. I need to sleep over that, but I think they come very beautifully together. Before we go and have a bite together, please also allow me to give you advance notice of the fourth installment in our lecture series. We will be starting a new series of talks on faith and knowledge in Judaism and Islam. Most probably we start in November. And we want to devote our time to the relationship and our reflections to the relationship between science and the two faiths. And we would be very pleased to see you here all again in autumn. And before we go outside, I would like to thank the whole Academy team for your wonderful lecture series, and I know the enormous amount of work which goes into organizing these series, not only the intellectual brain energies trying to search and matchmake the people. There was a click here tonight, I feel. And of course, the whole logistical side to it. So thank you very much, the wonderful Academy team. And last but not least, the wonderful ladies in the box, our translators of this evening. And I'm sorry that the ones who have fasted today, because we are almost have the 21st of June, you still have to wait a few more minutes before you can eat. But we need to start a bit earlier, otherwise we need to leave the building without any food at all. So thank you so much. And also all the people who have watched from their homes or wherever you are, I hope you were inspired by these wonderful people and the wonderful audience. Thank you, and we also hope to see you very soon in the Jewish Museum. Thank you.